continuing the maimer of Ve'ata Tetzaveh. That was said on Parshas Tetzaveh, Tashin Chofei, 1965. Ve'inyan b'zeh she'af she'madregas ha'chochmah. Learn the chochmah is shemen, represented by shemen. Shemen is reference to chochmah. Itachlis habitul. Alach haskam v'chama mokoyr ha'chochmah. So if shemen that comes out of the olives is bitul and wisdom, how much more so mekoyr chokhma, the source of chokhma, which is the olive, zayis, uvifrash la'achir zeh utzuchulovis ha'shemen meishe. Afterward, they needed to bring the oil to Moshe Rabbeinu. Shinyanu tachlis bitul. What was Moshe? Moshe was the epitome of bitul. The ultimate bitul, k'meishe kosu v'nachnu ma. It says v'nachnu ma. Moshe Rabbeinu says, "What importance do we have? Kol mokim tzich lius gam bitul the kosis. But you need to have also the bitul of kosis. Bitul sheni, and we mentioned that's the bitul of tshuva." What tshuva Moshe Rabbeinu needs to do? What tshuva tzaddikim needs to do? So it says, "Shegam es Moshe Rabbeinu tzach lesinyan tshuva." And the Zohar says, "The Mashiach also lasvar tzaddikah b'siusa." The Mashiach will bring tzaddikim, will make tzaddikim to do tshuva. What does it mean? Ki tzaddikim yosef tachas habitu. Tzadik, although he is completely nullified to Hashem, ve'inu shach le'inyan shel yeshus, and is not connected with yeshus, with arrogancy whatsoever. Ve'gam ha'bitul shelo be'izat tziu. This bitul has a frame, has a form, has a definition. The lochan tzich lefil ba'atzmo liyos ha'inyan dekoti. That's why it needs to be kosis. Der daf zer zich erst tzeishtoisen. He has to crush himself. We call inyan shatziyo to get rid of any type of definition. That his bitul will be above definition. Should not be defined. This bitul, that bitul. This much, that much. Zoinyan a bitul the tshuva, and this is the bitul of tshuva. It's an attitude of lack of satisfaction. Asura mikan liskor of sham. Rashi says, Rashi explained, and Moshe says that asura mikan, asura no ve'ere. So Rashi said, when Moshe Rabbeinu saw the burning bush, he said, "Asur no," and then ve'ere, which means, I will distance myself from my previous state, and then I will come to the new state. And that's when this is exactly where we ended off yesterday. Pizesh levoer gamayim akol gushat adom rashab. Explained the maimer of the Rebbe Rashab, Nishmosa Eden. He has a Rebbe Rashab, one of his books called Teras Sholem. So there is a maimer there in Teras Sholem. Oides Gila Chassidus. He speaks about the revelation of Chassidus in the world. Sheyischir beikar la'achrei Petrov. That the explosion of Chassidus started after his imprisonment in Petrov. And he says, "Ma zayis zek shakoishin oisim oisisham no." He says, "Just this olive. When you crush it, it brings out oil." The primary revelation of Chassidut, the wellspring of Chassidut, chutza to the outside, started primarily after the imprisonment and the misery, the torture that. The Alter Rebbe went through, and that was Ketisha. That was the crushing. Makdim the Rebbe Rashab, prefacing Agam Shekol Shalem, he says, this is something that is very difficult to say, that the Alter Rebbe needed to be crushed in order to reveal Chassidus. The Rebbe Rashab himself says, Kol Shalem, and it's very difficult for me to say so. Ella, give Shalem, okay. Sharektishas Azayis, we got Shumalim al Hashem. It says, why are we crushing the olive? Because it can seal the oil. As we said, Valderech, it says in Zoyar, the Losalik Beinir Mavachinle, the log that doesn't catch fire, we chop it, we crush it. A big piece of wood. You can't say it in regards to the Alter Rebbe. What, the Alter Rebbe, God forbid, had a deficiency that in order to correct it, he needed to beat us, he needed to go to jail, he needed the imprisonment. What is the meaning of Vitul the causes? What do you mean this nullification, this crushing? It says the union of causes, the crushing, needs to be done even in the higher level, in the source of the oil, which is the olive. And what? Remember we said the olives are rooted in kesser. The oil is connected with Atzilus. The olives are connected with, the olives themselves are connected with Yoshes Choshech Sisro, a place that higher than the darkness there is a positive darkness. It's a darkness of, it's a concealment of Kedusha. It's a concealment because of the greatness, not because they're trying to hide something. Shazer bitul the tshuva. Shadugmos inyan aysur amisurus nefesh v'maisa. That's the example of tshuva, the nullification of tshuva, that the bitul is not going to be any more defined in any way. And its example was the pain and the suffering, the self-sacrifice in the imprisonment. The causes needs to be also done with by Moshe Rabbeinu. The intention of what he said, he said that it's difficult to say so. He wanted to awaken, to arouse with those that were listening to him, wanted to arouse them to do the tshuva, even those that were around them in a level of tzaddik, to do tshuva, that their bittul should not be limited in any way or defined in any way. In order to come to tshuva, such a high level of tshuva, not tshuva for sins, tshuva that the bittul is not perfect to nullify any kind of definition of bittul. Yes, the kosher, they need to, it requires hard work. And this obviously speaks also for every single Jew, even someone that didn't reach yet this level, that he needs courses in the higher level. It says you shouldn't think that you need to have the aspect of crushing of causes only because you are dealing with the world, with business, eating, drinking, because you're involved with permissible things, with the mundane. When it comes to these things, Kedusha and godliness is concealed. without maybe there is no bitul whatsoever. There's a lack of bitul. And these things can lead you to yeshus, to arrogancy, the opposite of refinement, the opposite of purity. Elagam b'isku b'nyan kedusha, but also while he's involved with holy matters, with holy things, limud haTorah, for example, learning Torah, is boyenus b'tfila, or contemplating in prayer, v'kiyum mitzvah b'idu, and fulfillment of a mitzvah with being scrupulous about doing a mitzvah, doing the mitzvah in a beautiful way. Tzorech lius, you need the kosis. Even in that, in these things, you have to have kosis. A bitul tshuva, gam benegal etzirut kedusha. There's a bitul tshuva that creates or add to his learning tshuva that would beautify his fulfillment of mitzvahs, tshuva that would beautify his prayer. Velulei zois, without, so anything that is connected with his mitzvahs, this is how I do it, this is how it's being done in my family, this is how I can do, he has to nullify. Anything that he limits to himself or to define it, even regular people that are not in the level of a tzaddik still have to get out of this I. But not the I of arrogance over here, is not speaking about arrogance, it's speaking about I, the I that limits, the I that defined things, to break through any boundaries. As we said, even a tzaddik has to get out of his bitul, should not be limited to, should not be defined in any way. So by us, it's on a low level, but it also have to break through it. Says, if not for that, if not for this kotish, for this kosis being crushed, a person is not doing it, not finding a way to crush his work, meaning to crush in order to improve, he can come to the second type of azai, the second type of olive, the olive that is bitter, the olive that is connected with impurity, the olive that is connected with bitterness, the olive that causes you to forget the learning of 70 years, right? No. Hey.
Robert, if the Zayid is from a higher level, the Guf is also from a higher level than the Neshama?
Yeah, we learned it before. And the Guf has the Guf is the Sof, right? The end. So the end is connected to the beginning. So if they, if it's connected to the beginning, it's connected to a higher level.
The Guf is higher than
Neshama. The Neshama needs the body to get to reach a higher level. You say Yerida, the descent is for the Aliyah, for the ascent. So when the ascent happens, after the Neshama is vested in the body, meaning without the body, the Neshama wouldn't be able to get to this, yeah, this type of elevation. In general, this concept of crushing the olive, when do we crush the olive? When we want the oil. Why do we want the oil? To illumine, to produce light. As it says, Kosis, Lamoir, why are you crushing? For the luminary, for the light. This is the concept of lighting the menorah. Shakavona bezeh, what is the purpose in that? He bishvil la'oir ha'olam, in order to illumine the world. Spiritually, to bring godly revelation into the world. Kemaimar Rabbi Seinu Zal, as the Gemara says in Menaches, Peivav, regarding the lighting of the menorah, it says, Lo leora nitzarich. I don't need its light, Hashem says. Velachen ayu beveit hamikdash chalonei shkufim atumim. And that's why the Beit HaMikdash had a very specific type of windows, kedei lotzi ora la'olam, in order for the light to protrude, to illumine the world. Usually a regular window, the objective of it, the objective of it is to bring light from the outside to the inside. In Beit HaMikdash, it was the opposite. The idea was to bring the light of the Beit HaMikdash to the outside. The Gemara says over there, Shulchan Batzafon. The Shulchan was placed in the north, Umenorah Badarom, and the menorah was placed in the south. So the Gemara says there, Amar Bizerika Amar Bilazar, and the Gemara, I don't need the food and I don't need the light. It says, Shlomo HaMelech Vayas Shlomo Labayit Chalonei Shkufim Atumim. Atum means that it's sealed. What is it? So it says, Shkufim, they were see-through from the inside, but they were sealed on the outside. And Lo Leora Nitzarich, I don't need its light. מחוץ לפרוכת, העדות outside of the פרוכת, באוהל מועד, it says, it was a testimony לכל באי העולם, to all the inhabitants of the world, שהשכינה שורה בישראל, to show that divine presence is dwelling within the Jewish people. והעניין בזה, שהזית מצד עצמו, the olive by itself, מצד גודל מעלתו, אינו זקוק לעניין דקתית, the olive itself doesn't need to be crushed because Godel Malato, as we said, it's connected all the way to Keter. וגם אינו יכול להגיע לעניין דקתית כי אין לך דבר שיכול לפעול בו הביטול דקתית. He cannot even reach קתית because there's nothing they can cause him שיכול לפעול בו הביטול, nothing they can cause this type of nullification of קתית. Because of its greatness, no one has influence on him. Something needs to be in its level in order to influence it, right? V'rak yesher tzrichim lotzi min hashem el menorah. Only when we need oil for the menorah of the Beit HaMikdash, kedei la'ir la'olam, in order to bring light to the world, ini mitzad ha'shayachut l'tziur ha'olam shemechutz ha'kedusha. Why do we need to illumine the world? Because the world is outside of the realm of Kedusha, of sanctity. Yesh tzorech b'inyan dekatit. We need to crush the olive. Shezeu abitu l'tzet me'atziur shelo. Kedei la'ir l'olam. So what we're saying to the olive, you yourself don't need to be crushed. The only reason why we're crushing you is because we need your light to shine to the world. So it's like the crushing of a tzaddik. He's telling him, your bitul is beautiful, everything is nice. But you are in your cocoon, it's defined. In order to get out of that definition,
help the others.
We need to crush the olive. So the olive for itself doesn't need to be crushed. It's only when he needs to now relate himself, so to speak, to the world, we need to crush him. Chmo neshama, the godless soul of every Jew, shedavka beiradata lemata, the neshama descend into this world, levarer et haguf anefesh be'amit. What is the objective of the neshama being in this body? It says it needs to elevate the body, to refine the body, to separate the good from the bad, and to elevate them to Kedusha. To elevate the good to Kedusha. Arei zekuka le'inyan ha'tshuva. So there's need to the tshuva. The neshama itself doesn't need to the tshuva. But since it's in the body, it needs tshuva. Arei magat, because of this descent, v'koach ha'yirida, because of the power of this descent, being one with Hashem, coming into this physical world, into a physical body, into an animalistic soul, arei magat la'ilui devale tshuva asher mala mitzadikim. The neshama can reach the level of baal tshuva, a true baal tshuva that is higher than a tzaddik. So it's explained in Chassidut that through the irida of the neshama lemata, right, the neshama descending down, she is able to reach aliyah to a place where much higher than where she came from. Rapize is so holding in Vav, line 16, Amud Yud Bet. Rapize Yuvan Mashekatu, it says, Vatata Tzaveh Bnei Yisrael, you should command the Jewish people, Vikhu Elecha, they should take the oil to you, to Moshe Rabbeinu. We asked the question, why do they need to bring the oil to Moshe Rabbeinu if Aaron was the one to light the menorah? It's like having an unnecessary middleman, seemingly, right? He's not lighting the menorah. Why to bring the oil to him? Bikhu elecha, bring it to Aaron.
Inspection.
Va'pizi yuvan. Well, they can inspect it and then bring it to Aaron directly. Va'pizi yuvan meshekatu v'ikhu elecha. They bring the olive oil to Moshe, El Moshe. Av shadlakat ha'menorah u'tzricha liyot al yedei Aaron. The lighting of the menorah needed to be done by Aaron, ve'lo al yedei Moshe. Moshe was not the Kohen Gadol. He was not the high priest. ובפרט שהשם לא יכול להיות ממונו של משה, אלא הוא צריך להיות ממון ציבור דווקא. And if you would argue that the Moshe Rabbeinu paid for it, so therefore it comes from him, it says no, he cannot. Moshe Rabbeinu was not allowed to pay for it. The olive oil needed to come from ממון ציבור, from the money of the community. So the question is become even stronger. Why the Shemen had to come through Moshe Rabbeinu? So the answer is, Ki b'chdei la'adlik et ha'menorah b'shvil la'ir et ha'olam. What was the purpose of the menorah? To light the world, not the Beit HaMikdash. As we said before, V'chi amar Rabbi Elazar, amar Rabbi Zarika, V'chi la'orah u'tzarich, Hashem needs the oil. Hashem needs the food on the table there, in the Kodesh. We needed to light up the world. In order to light up the world, we need the level of Moshe Rabbeinu. Yes.
Tzorech. Well, Aaron was not as good as Moshe. That's why they gave to Moshe instead of Aaron.
It wasn't enough. Yes. Tzorech b'madrigat ha'bitul de Moshe. The special level in Moshe Rabbeinu, the level of bitul of Moshe Rabbeinu. It says, "Achar shenasa zlonyan de katit." After Moshe Rabbeinu went through katit, he went through ktisha, he went through crushing. He reached a higher level of bitul, and that's the bitul of tzaddikim. Even tzaddik goes through ktisha, he goes through crushing.
Well, he did it himself.
In his level.
But Aaron has already a bitul, Rabbi.
Moshe, of course.
Maybe two is better than one.
No, he couldn't bring an offer to the altar.
See it all the way. V'zehu ha'netinat koach. It says v'zehu ha'netinat koach le'aron la'ir et ha'olam. Al yedei hadlakat ha'menorah. So Moshe Rabbeinu had to some way to bestow his power to Aaron in order for Aaron. That's what it says. V'akrev elecha et Aaron. Hashem tells Moshe Rabbeinu in this week, in the parasha, this week says, Akrev alecha et Aaron ve'et banav. You should bring Aaron and his sons closer to you, meaning that you have to give them from your powers to Aaron. So it's over here the same thing. And v'zoya netinat koach la'aron la'ir et ha'olam, giving Aaron the power to illumine the world al yedei hadlakat ha'menorah, through lighting the menorah, shu tzricha liyot b'fo'al, in actuality needed to be by Aaron and not by Moshe. And he's explaining it even more. What does it mean? And Moshe Rabbeinu is giving his older brother, Netinat Koach, is giving him strength is so to speak transmitting to him the power of his bitul, the power of his nullification to our own. Because Moshe Rabbeinu himself is comparing his bitul to our own as if they are the same. When the Jewish
Hashem
people
is not agreeing with that. That's why he told Moshe to go,
right,
to do this instead
when
of
when the Jewish people complain to they complain on Moshe and Aaron, so Moshe spoke in a plural way. He says v'nachnu ma. Many times in Kabbalah, Hasidut, they want to describe the bitul of Moshe and Aaron. They say v'nachnu ma, that Moshe Rabbeinu said about himself and Aaron, who are we that you are complaining to us? What importance do we have that you are complaining to us? They didn't consider themselves anything special. He said, you have a complaint, bring it to God.
Look, it's not that they tried to be anavim, but the same token, we know.
They weren't trying, they were humble people. They weren't trying to be. But it says in Kabbalah and Hasidut, describe to us the level of your humility. They said, v'nachnu ma, what is ma? Ma is nothing. What? Who are we that you're bringing your complaints to? But we still have to see why is it that Moshe Rabbeinu is the one that giving over his level of bitul to our own. What type of crushing did he go through? What is the katit that he went through that he can now bring it over to our own? V'anyan b'zeh k'mvar b'arukah b'drushim. It's explained in many Hasidic discourses shanetinat koach al inyan adlakat ha-menorah al yedei Moshe davka. That this a transfer of power, so to speak, from Moshe Rabbeinu to Aaron to specifically light the menorah. Why was it done specifically through Moshe? Ulayir gam imamar ubaten zuchon v'racha al pasuk. It says about Moshe Rabbeinu that when he was born, v'tere oto kitov hu. It's written about Moshe Rabbeinu that when he was born, his mother Yocheved saw kitov hu, that he is good. I ask you a question. What good do you see in a baby? He's a baby.
Exactly.
He didn't even prove himself. He didn't show anything, different qualities, different. So what does it mean kitov hu? It says shenemar b'Moshe shebeshaa shenolad nitmale habayit kulo ora. The whole house was filled with light. So she said, this is a special kid, right? So we see, first of all, we can learn about the connection of Moshe Rabbeinu and the relationship to light. There's got to be some connection to light. Although he's not the one to light the menorah, but he has something in him that has to do with light. So it says that Moshe Rabbeinu is the only one, is the only tzaddik that you say his name, and then you say our rabbi. Usually you say Rabbi Shimon, Rabbi Meir. Moshe, and then say Rabbeinu. He says, who gave the name Moshe to Moshe? It says, Batya, the daughter of Pharaoh, gave the name Moshe. Why did she give him the name Moshe? Because she pulled him out of the water. But if you follow this reasoning, you should have write Mashui. She should have called him Mashui. I pulled you out of the water. But she called him Moshe, which means he is pulling out of the water. He is pulling. So she is describing really not the past of what was done to Moshe, how he was brought to the world. Rather, she's saying that this person will be Moshe. He will be the one to pull others. He will be the one to pull the Jews out of Mitzrayim. He'll be the one to bring the Torah to the Jews. He'll be the one to carry them and their needs 40 years in the desert.
Hashem, the Moshe, the letters themselves have a
obviously there's many interpretations, but if you look at the simple meaning of the word Moshe, it means someone that pulls, not someone that was pulled.
Right.
Because if she wanted to say that someone that he was a person that was pulled out of the water, she would say Mashui in the past. I pulled them out. But rather she said Moshe, someone that constantly pulling others. That's and this is the same idea. It says Moshe Rabbeinu was born The whole house is filled with light. So shaledo yamshachat Torah. Why the Torah? Moshe kibel Torah misinai. Why the Torah was not given to Aaron to give it to the Jews? Moshe kibel Torah
misinai. Aaron was not the leader as the leader for
right.
Am Israel.
No, but there's a deeper reason, not just because somebody has a title and one guy doesn't have a title. It has to speak about his very essence, why he's the qualified person to lead the Jewish people.
Me too. Well, obviously the tafkidim has been given by Hashem.
They say there's a leader with no title, and there is a title to a leader who doesn't know how to lead. So, what would you prefer? A title to a leader who doesn't know how to lead, or a true leader, but he doesn't have a title? So, you have a lot of leaders out there, good leaders, that don't have a title. And then you have leaders that have a title, but don't really know how to lead. So, we call them leaders. But then, Moshe Rabbeinu, his essence, as soon as he was, at the moment that he was born, he came to shine, to light the world, to give light to the world. So, he writes, Shal yado hi amshachat haTorah. Through Moshe Rabbeinu is the drawdown, bringing the Torah to Am Yisrael. Sheinyana hu gilui yichudo yitparech lemata kmo lemala. What is the idea of Kabbalat haTorah? Bringing the Torah. The inner purpose of bringing the Torah, he writes, Sheachdut Hashem, that the unity of God will be revealed down here the way it is upstairs. That's the true essence of revealing the Torah. V'zehu gamma shegabei Moshe ne'emar, it says regarding Moshe Rabbeinu, regarding the amount of time that the menorah needs to be lit, it says le'alot ner tamid, meaning that the menorah had to be lit constantly. Ki ha'gilui shal edei ha'Torah hu be'ofen shelamala me'achilukim de'yom ve'layla. The revelation of Torah stands above the limitations of day and night. These are terms that are born from the limitation of the world, day and night. V'inyano b'avodahu ma sh'neshama hu tamid be'omna ito itbarach. It says, explaining Tanya, the neshama itself always connected with Hashem. Even at the time of sinning, the neshama is connected with God. והדלקת המנורה בפועל להאיר ולברר את העולם, the lighting of the menorah in actuality, to light up and to elevate the world, הנה על זה נאמר יערוך אותו אהרון מערב עד בוקר. So it's written about Aaron that he has to set it up from evening till the morning. What is evening till the morning? As the Gemara said, "Shezeu b'ofen bereisha chashucha v'adar neorah," which means it starts off with darkness. It starts off with darkness. Bereisha chashucha is darkness, and afterwards is a state of light, illumination. The Gemara says that usually the black goats are the ones that leads the flock. Right? You have white and black goats. The black goats will be the one to lead the flock. The Gemara says, you see, the Bereisha Chashucha, beginning, it starts off with darkness, with difficulty, with challenges, and then it comes to light. Chaydua Binyan, the Zohar says regarding the Pasuk, Roni V'Simchi Bat Zion, Renana Beramsha, meaning joy, Rina, will be at night, V'Simcha B'Tzafo, and happiness will be connected with the morning. So the Zohar telling us that the beginning of the Avodah, the beginning of the service, serving Hashem, it's still, when there is still concealment, when everything is still hidden, and then you only have a limited joy, which is called Rina. But afterwards, when you overcome the darkness, then the morning comes, the light comes, that leads to Simcha. So from a state of Rina, a limited joy, to a great joy, to Simcha. V'frat yud yoter kemvar v'echad, ha-bichlach. Bichlach is a ktav yad, is a handwritten Chassidic discourse that was found, Shalon Pesuadain, Sharon Ushushvina de Matrunita. It says Aaron was the Shushvin is the best man, right?
Matrunita.
Matrunita is the queen. And Moshe Rabbeinu is Shushvina. And Moshe Rabbeinu is Shushvina de Malka, is the best man of the king, right? So it says, the queen, what is the queen? The spiritual meaning of it, it's explained to Ra'o. And this week, hopefully, we'll get to it. Aaron, Shushvina de Matrunita. Matrunita is the source of Neshamot Israel. Aaron is the best man. Like the bride and the groom that need someone to walk with them. Halachically, the first week, you have to walk with the chatan. He is not allowed to walk alone. If he wants to walk to get groceries, he has to have somebody that comes with him. He's like a married king.
After they're married?
Or? The first week, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Why is that?
Because he's considered like a melech. It says the chatan is like a king. And he needs someone to walk with him. It has importance.
People actually do that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I remember walking with other guys that were, I think it was 5 days before they get married, and then during and the week of after they got married. I did it to other people, and people did it with me also. When I got married.
We can check you.
Listen, you get paid the best man, you gotta do your job to the end.
Already,
double checking.
If you meet Hatan and Hatan, Sarah the team, Haradim, you should meet Tushi, though. He meet Tushi, Walif Nechen, and the Dalian Shulek. It's more Alaf
Shalom.
I don't think so. כמו על דרך משל חתן וכלה, for example, bride and groom, שצריכים שושבין ללך עמהם, לפי שאי אפשר להם ללך בעצמם, they're not supposed to walk by themselves, מחמת הבושה, וצריך סעד לתומכם. They need to support them, to give them a...
What is the בושה here? Should be simcha, no בושה. That's something happy, how could it be בושה? מתחתנים, it's a big deal.
He said, כך להיות... Right.
So this goes back to what you said before, that the reason the oil is given to Moshe to be given to Aaron is because both of them represent one the bride, the other one the king, and together they're going to basically do this lighting of the oil.
The menorah. Right. But as we said, the lighting of the menorah has to light up the world. And in order to have the power to light up the world, Aaron needed the power of Moshe Rabbeinu with him. Shehu, and he writes, Shushvina de Matrunita, so telling us about who is Aaron. Aaron is the best man of the queen. Bechina Dibur Elyon. Aaron is connected with Dibur, and Aaron was the one to speak to Paro. It says, V'uyeh lecha lepe. Right? Hashem says to Moshe Rabbeinu, Aaron will be your mouth. V'uyeh lecha lepe. So we see that in his source, it was connected with Dibur Elyon, with the supernal speech. Misham nimshach hayut ha'olamot. That's where the life, the vitality comes to the world. Al yedei asara ma'amarot. So the world was created with 10 utterances. Dibur also, speech. Aval Moshe hu shushvina de malka. Moshe is the best man for the king. V'arilav urcha de malka lishtai b'mile de idiota. It says, it's not the way of the king to be involved with simple matters, with things of idiot, meaning things that are mundane. שעניין חיות העולמות to be dealing with the life of the world, אלא בדברי תורה דווקא. So Moshe Rabbeinu, so to speak, on his level, he doesn't deal with the life of the world. He deals with דברי תורה. Moshe Rabbeinu brought the Torah. It says, therefore, Moshe Rabbeinu, the best man of the king, was able to bring about the Torah. פעל המשכת התורה. Aaron, what did Aaron do? Amshachat elokut l'olam. So Aaron's job was to bring godliness into the world. Moshe Rabbeinu's job was to bring the Torah into the world. Amshachat haTorah, as the representative of the king.
Hashem never spoke to Aaron.
He did. וחמבואר שם שזהו גם מה שאמרו רבותינו זל. רבי סד נגמרה עם שבת שמי שתורתו אומנותו פטור מן התפילה. If the Torah, that's, if your Torah is your profession, that's your profession, only Torah, then you don't have to daven, you don't have to pray. Why? Abba, halachically today we don't follow it, but Gemara in Shabbat says, Bishon Bar Yochai, and those tzaddikim, they didn't have to pray at the time. כעניין שמונה עשרה ברכות התפילה, what is the point of שמונה עשרה? What are we trying to accomplish with שמונה עשרה, בתפילת שמונה עשרה? So he writes, להמשיך אלוקות. Idea of שמונה עשרה is to bring אלוקות into the world, from above down, to draw down שפה, physical שפה, health, happiness, wealth, whatever people need. חינת אור ושפה גשמי, חיי שעה, things that are passing anyway. Things that are... temporary things we ask him to bring into the world. He says, but one second, limud Torah, learning Torah is also bringing elokut into the world. It's called chayei netzach. Learning Torah is called the eternal life. ולכן מי שתורתו אומנותו פטור מן התפילה. It's a tefila bringing into the world temporary life. Torah is bringing into the world permanent life. And therefore, Torah supersede tefillah. ולכן מי שתורתו אומנותו הוא פטור מן התפילה. כיוון שגם על ידי עסק התורה, that's why you, the one who is learning Torah, and that's his profession, he is exempt from tefillah, from prayer. כיוון שגם על ידי עסק התורה ממשיך אלוקות מלמעלה למטה. So because through Torah, he is also bringing אלוקות.
You're doing it 24/7.
Right. Ubeofen aleoter, and even the elokut, and even the what he brings into the world is even is greater than what tefillah bring into the world. Umichol makom. Nevertheless, in a gam yishet torato umanuto. He brings a simple explanation. He says the same way that 200, if you have 200, it includes within it the 100. He says the Torah is resembled to the 200, the tefillah is resembled to the 100. So learning Torah, it's obviously included within it the aspect of tefillah. ומכל מקום, הנה גם מי שתורתו אומנותו מפסיק לקריאת שמע, הלכה קריאת שמע, he needs to stop. Prayer, no, but to say שמע ישראל is he has to stop. כי אי אפשר להיות המשכה בלא העלאת תחילה. It says you can't have המשכה, drawdown of godly light down from Hashem בלא העלאת תחילה without elevation. You need to elevate, you need to bring something upward. You need to get closer to Elokut. ואף שעניין תורתו אומנותו הוא כמו רבי שמעון בר יוחאי. So what is תורתו אומנותו? Who represented this title? Who had this title? תורתו אומנותו, אז רבי שמעון בן יוחאי, שאמר, באחד כתירא את קטרנא, סוויתן אין זוהר, חלק ג', I'm connected with one knot, I'm connected, היינו שהוא תמיד בבחינת העלה, that he is constantly in a state of elevation from below. So why does he need to stop for learning? Why does he need to stop for קריאת שמע? He is always in that state of elevation. הרי זה רק שאינו צריך להתעוררות שעל ידי פסוקי דזמרה. He doesn't need the awakening of פסוקי דזמרה. פסוקי דזמרה is placed in the סידור in order for us to be aroused. When we get to קריאת שמע, we can get to ואהבת את השם אלוקיך. But רבי שמעון בר יוחאי didn't need this awakening of Psukei de Zimra, because he was on that state to begin with. But he himself needed the elevation of Shema, that's why he stopped for Kriyat Shema. And this, the elevation of Kriyat Shema, you cannot reach without the Shema. He needed to have the Shema. Umosif sham, and he adds Vayen Yerushalmi uvaba maor resh perekama the Shabbat. Mashma shelo haya mafsik gam lekriat Shema. It says it from the Yerushalmi. It sounds like Rabbi Shimon Baruch Hai didn't even stop for Kriyat Shema. He didn't stop his learning from Kriyat Shema. Itachen lefi ma shekatuv v'chad katira. It says it's not contradicting, because Rabbi Shimon Baruch Hai, when it says v'chad katira, there is opinion that he did stop for Kriyat Shema. There are different opinions. V'uva b'mor ish perkama de Shabbat mashma shelo haya mafsik. גם לקריאת שמה ייתכן לפי מה שכתוב בחד קטירה, דברים אלה סותרים, seemingly it's contradicting what we said before, that רבי שמעון בר יוחאי did stop for קריאת שמה, ויש לבאר זה על פי מבואר בהמשך תפו יש סמך ובואר, we can explain this seeming contradiction from the teaching of the Rebbe Rashab in his famous Chassidic work under the title תפו יש סמך ובואר. V'inyan aliyah is the lost level regarding the elevations that are going to happen in the time of Mashiach. V'sheichuson l'seudus the Shabbos, and the connection, the elevations of the time of Mashiach, and the connection to the Shabbos meal. Sheshlemut aliyah delatid lavo, that the ultimate elevation in the time of Mashiach, la'achir shekuyam yehud, after the fulfillment of the prophecy of Zechariah. What was the prophecy? Ruach atuma avir menoretz. The spirit of impurity I will remove from the land. Ivechinas menucha be'etzem. Which means, that's what it says in Emshech Tafri Samachvav. Menucha be'etzem, which means menucha. Rest that is not for accomplishing any purpose. What usually menucha is to restore your energy. You had an amount of energy, you used it, now you are depleted, and you want to get back the energy, so you are resting. But in time of Mashiach, it says, Menucha, it's not for the purpose of rejuvenating. It's not for that purpose. It says, Menucha she'eino l'shem ator mesuyemes, ela beglal ha'mailo v'ayinik shem menucha atzmet. We find the greatness of the Menucha for itself. The rest itself would understand its the greatness
like
of the Menucha. Yeah, she'az, at that time, la'osid lov, in the time of Mashiach, when the elevation will be complete, when the elevation will be perfect, i'inyan shel yiridot ve'aliyot, we're going to experience the inyan of yiridot, of descent and elevation, u'inyan yom shekulo shabbat, meaning that in the time of Mashiach, we're not going to have yiridot and aliyot, downward, and are going upward. Rather, with Unyan Shekulo Shabbat, it's time that it's all rest. Menucha lechaye olamim, it's eternal rest. And we come to this stage, there is no need in the avodah of elevation from below that would bring the drawdown from above. And on that level, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai did not need to stop from his learning even for Kriyat Shema. So we can solve the seeming contradiction that one place it says Rabbi Shimon Baruch Hai stopped for Kriyat Shema, one place he didn't stop for Kriyat Shema. We can say that at certain levels that he possessed, he did stop. But when he reached the level of, like the time of Mashiach, that there was no, I need to elevate in order to bring down, like the state of Shabbos, then he didn't even need to stop for Shema. Buchem Tim.